All I knew about Mel Wasserman was that he had a house in, I think it was San Francisco. Is that right? It was somewhere in California. And he apparently started taking hippies in from the street and had problems, and they would just talk about life. And he realized that he was really helping them out, so he started this school. That's all I know about him. Mel was coming to speak at the school, and I think maybe there was, it was under 20 students got picked to listen to him speak. This was like a big privilege, We were like gonna hear the, be able to talk to like this guy who like all the staff look up to, all the staff kiss up to, basically everyone's boss. He was supposed to be this, this fountain of knowledge who knew every angle of the school, must know everything that's going on with everybody in the school. He was just the guy, the creator of this, the theory, the program.
In those days, downtown Palm Springs, it was a single road. And the very center of it had the library on one corner, and across the street was a eating place where a lot of the businessmen ate. The library has some stairs going up to the main door, and students or protesters would just stand there and provoke the drivers by, or have some signs or something like that. And the way I understand it, Mel, eating with his business friends across the corner, diagonal across, was interested to hear what the college kids had to say or the high school kids had to say. Went over and engaged them in a conversation. And then at some point, I think just early on, maybe first conversation even, said, if you want, come over to the house, we'll make spaghetti up and we'll just talk. And right on, early, maybe one or two meetings, the guy came by to say, "I'm getting kicked out," or, "I've been kicked out and I, have to leave. Thanks for being a grown-up that listened." So Mel said, "Well, you can stay here if you want, but you've got to, okay, and so here's where the see-do thing starts, but you've got to do some chores and we've got some agreements, whatever." Quickly, there was a bunch of people in the same circumstances, either getting thrown out by their folks or something or other like that, staying at the Wasserman house. And these people were, middle 20s. They would live at the place and they'd go out and they'd work at a service station or run something or other like that. They bought some sort of place there and were running a kind of a rehab commune. EST was a big thing that was going on at the time. LifeSpring was a big thing. That there were these weekend workshops, in the back of magazines, full pages of different ads. Here's this opportunity. Here's this opportunity. And he was going to those things, experiencing it, whatever he experienced, and then coming back and kind of plugging this stuff in. On a Not on a professional basis, just on his own. "Oh, that was great. I had a great experience there. Let me try this." They were trying to stay one step ahead of maybe the health authorities, saying, "You're not running something appropriate here, that you need to have this kind of standard and this kind of standard." Meanwhile, the courts were sending people there instead of going to jail because it sounded like you might be able to help these people. They're maybe they're addicted or they've gotten into some difficulty. "I don't want to send them to prison," the judge is saying. "I don't want to send them to prison. Put in a half year there and then we'll review," and then I remember they had a bunch of facilities in Running Springs, sort of in the industrial area down kind of behind Lloyd's there. And they were getting people to give them stuff and then they could sell it and raise funds to support their enterprise. And they had a variety of ways of getting funds. For my own purposes, I went to that those salvage things and buying a bunch of different, they had pipe, they had a wire that maybe Edison had given them, and all kinds of that just strange things that didn't relate to. But they were selling very cheaply just to raise money. And the students who were, you know, the 25-year-old students would run that stuff. And then my understanding is sometime around maybe 83 or something like that, they were wondering what's the direction of the place. They had some sort of workshop with the key people there. And that's where the idea of the high school thing came out of it, because they thought, like, you know, we've been dealing with these heavy-duty drug addicts. We need to get people before that their life has gone that far in that direction. We need to run a high school.
So yeah, he came to speak, and yeah, and it, when you get called on for a question, you're supposed to stand up with your question, and a lot of kids were just asking him, or would say, like, I just got out of this prof feat, or I'm this far along in the program, and I've noticed that I'm going through this or that, and, you know, what should I do? And as Mel had the answer.
Mel was built up as this visionary who every idea that was in RMA sprung fully formed out of his head, you know. And then I, like, found out, actually through the Cult Awareness Network before the Scientologists bought them or took over, is that the connection with Sidhu, or not Sidhu, with Synanon. And he was there. And then I started reading about Synanon and the game, and I was like, the game, raps, okay. And then I did some more research about LifeSpring and EST and Large Group Awareness Training, and I'm like, yeah, that's, you know, LifeSpring was the summit. You know, I bought the copyright. So, and then I did some research into, you know, Primal Scream and bioenergetic analysis, and which he also used.
I think a lot of these things got plugged into the group sessions little by little by different staff that would show up and say, well, let's try this. Let's do this.
He didn't think of a damn thing on his own, pretty much. He was like Madonna of, like, the troubled teen industry. He just borrowed everything else and said it was his own idea.
Mel started going on this rant about how he's simply here from the kindness of his heart, how he's here not to make a profit. He said that, you know, he's not here. He like took this time out of his life to come here and help us because he really cares, and there's no financial ties to it. And he did show up, like, in a limousine and stuff, which I thought was very odd, you know, like, to look good for, like, who, like, a bunch of messed up kids, like, who cares, you know. In the back, there was, like, a video camera set up and someone recording him, like, someone he had obviously hired to come with. So I was like, if he's saying he's not doing this for money and just out of the kindness of his heart, like, why is this, like, a production? Like, why is this being videotaped and all that? So that's what I asked him, you know. I stood up. And I said, you said you're not doing this for the money and you're saying you're just here because you want to be. Like, why is this being tape recorded? And he said, because there's a lot of people in this room who need to hear what I have to say who aren't in this room. And I asked, so are you going to be, like, selling these tapes? And then Ned Murray, who was the headmaster, just told me to sit down. And that was it. That was my interaction. And Mel just moved on. I think he just said next question, and Ned told me to sit down. And then afterwards, the camera guy and Mel got back in the limousine and drove away. And apparently we were all blessed with his presence.